This morning, if you have your Bibles, I want you to turn back into the book of Joshua with me in chapter 1. We started a series in the book of Joshua called Claiming Your Country. Claiming Your Country last week. Last week, we said that Joshua was called to lead the children of Israel after Moses' death. He had a great task at hand. We found that the Israelites had wandered in the wilderness for 40 years. They were going around and around in a circle. All the generation that was in the land of Egypt had died out. A new generation had been rid up. Only two left, Joshua and Caleb, were able to go to the promised land that God had promised. Joshua is to lead this new generation. And God says, Joshua, I'm going to be with you. And we see the call from God, the call of duty. He said, I'm going to be with you, Joshua. I'm going to give you all the insight that you need to make things happen. He said, but I want you to be courageous. I want you to be bold. And I want you to be a strong leader. And friend, today, I believe if the United States of America is going to get back on the right course, it's got to have some strong leaders. Strong leaders in the pulpit, basically. Strong leaders in the home. Strong leaders in our nation capital. Strong leaders with a backbone and boldness to stand on the Word of God. I believe if we have that, then my friend, then I believe that we can turn the course of this nation around for the glory of God. But its call has got to be heeded by God for men and women to make a bold stand, a call to action. We just can't sit on the pew and do nothing any longer. We've seen what that has brought to our perspective by doing so. We see evil raging on every corner in our land. Why? Because people have not heeded the call of duty. They've sat and not taken action. And we've seen the devil run rampage over. It takes us, amen, standing up for him to stand up for us. And so, you know, we show the power of God through our lives, folks, through our lives and our actions and our deeds. So when we make a stand for God, amen, then he'll stand for us. But if we don't stand up, he's not going to stand up. He's going to give you what you want, give you what you ask for. And when you sit down and do nothing, you're asking for the devil to take over. For evil to prevail, good men needs to do nothing, one of the founding fathers said. For evil to prevail, good men needs to do nothing. But good men and women need to stand up. And Joshua was one who stood up, amen, in face of his obstacles and his enemies. And he said, I'll do it. He says, even told the children of Israel in the closing of the book of Joshua, he said, if it seems evil to serve this God that we serve, the God of all gods, he says, then you choose this day whom you're going to serve. But me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. We're going to be faithful. We're going to take that stand. And he took that challenge of God here. And he said, I'll take the people and I'll lead them to the promised land. And I'll do it. He says about Joshua, I want you to do one thing. I want you to take heed to all I've commanded you to do. The problem that we got, we don't take heed to what God's commanded us to do in his word. Some of us, let's face it, you know, we're not even faithful to the church. The little simple things. How can we be faithful to God's great big program if we're not faithful to the little things of God? And that's a good question. We say we love the Lord. We say we're born again on our way to heaven. But Jesus said, many are saying that day, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name, and your name done meaningful, wonderful works? But he said, depart from me, I never knew you. Why is he going to say that? Because we had a lip service, but no heart service. If you're in love with God, you'll do what he's commanded you to do wholeheartedly. And he's commanded us to be faithful, even in the little things. Faithful, amen, to him. Attending church, Bible study, witnessing, and so on and so on. It goes on. He's instructed us in his word to be faithful in all of those things. And he tells Joshua, he says, I want you to take heed to the commandments that I commanded you. How many of us really are teaching our children now about the Lord? Matter of fact, he in Deuteronomy, he's telling the children of Israel, you teach your children and your children's children. And you say, well, my children are grown. You got grandchildren, you need to be teaching them about the Lord and his statutes and his commandments. And if you ain't got children, then you need to teach your neighbor's children because evidently they're not being taught. Hello? It don't hurt to go over and ask your neighbor, can I take your child to church? But how many of us really do that today? Friend, today, when Joshua was challenged by God, God told him, he said, I want you to take heed. I want you to be ready and take charge. And I want you to feed off of my word. And feed on it daily, live by it, and you will be blessed. He said, "You'll be wherever your soles of your feet trod, you'll be successful." Great success comes from those people who heeds the Lord's command. So as God instructed Joshua, he started to instruct the people. Now the challenge is to the people. The challenge is to you today. Look in verse 10 with me in chapter 1. Then Joshua commanded the officers of the people, saying, pass through the host and command the people, saying, prepare your victuals, for within 3 days he shall pass over this Jordan to go into possess the land which the Lord your God giveth to you to possess. Now, first of all, in those 10 and 11th verse here, Joshua is commanded the people as a whole. He is challenging the whole Israelite group. He's challenged the people to get ready. Friend, today I am asking you to get ready because there is a great battle that we're going to confront. We've been wandering in the wilderness for 40 years as the children of Israel. And now God has said, it's time to move. It's time to move. So he says, prepare. Because see, the provisions that were prepared for them in the wilderness will no longer be available to them. There's a new day dawning, so they got to get new victuals. Friend, we cannot live off yesterday's blessings. We got to live off right now. And those blessings yesterday won't get us through the day. They're a good reminder of what God can do, but God wants to do greater things, and God is going to move you forward, and he's not going to leave you in the wilderness if you got a heart and soul, mind made up, amen, to walk in his path. He's going to lead you to the promises that he has laid out before you in the word of God. He wants you to get from the milk, amen, to the meat of the word. He wants you to be able, amen, to share that, amen, with a lost and dying world without compromise, without hindrance, and without reservation. So your food that you had yesterday won't get you through today. That's what Joshua said. Hey, you need to prepare you something different than what you've been eating. Prepare. Now, let me ask you this. Are you prepared to meet the Lord? Matter of fact, God instructed the people. He said, prepare to meet your God. Are you prepared to meet God? If God was returned today, would he be pleased with you? Have you prepared your heart for him? Have you done what he's commanded you to do? Are you ready to meet him without hesitation, without delay? Are you ready to stand before him and hear him say, welcome home, thou good and thou faithful servant. You've been faithful over a few things. I will make you ruler over many. Or will you hear him say, depart from me, I never knew you. Your heart was never for me. You came to church. You came to church on every day and every week. You came there, but your heart was far from me. You didn't do what I commanded you to do. You wasn't faithful over the few things. You didn't do. Would you be that one? Or would you be that one here and say, welcome home, thou good and faithful servant. You've been faithful in all things. So you'll inherit all things. It's a It's a good question, isn't it? Good question to ponder in our hearts and our minds. Have we been all we could be for the Lord Jesus Christ? And friend, if not, then we need to make a change. And the challenge is, let's prepare. Let's prepare to move on from where we are today to where God wants to take us tomorrow. Now, to prepare. How are we going to prepare? First of all, we need to get things right in our hearts with God. We need to get things right in our hearts with God. We got any sin in our life, we need to repent of it and turn from it and ask God to help us to overcome. And then we need to be in His Word day in and day out, meditating on it, applying it to our lives so we can move forward. That's the victuals that we need, hello? That's the food that we need. Matter of fact, Jesus, amen, tells Satan in Matthew 4, He said, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. We need to live off the Word of God. Folks, amen, everybody in here eats, and you want to eat. Why do you want to eat? Because that gives you the physical strength that you need, that your body needs to make it through the day. Then, friend, your spiritual soul needs to eat because, amen, it is the spiritual bread, amen, that you need, amen, to survive and you make your spirit strong within you, that you'll be bold and courageous, amen, in the face of your enemy. And you're facing the enemy. And it depends on the way this election goes, depends on whether you sit here like you are today or not. You mark it down. If the wrong people gets in office, it's coming down the road, and very shortly, you and I will not be able to worship God as freely as we are worshiping Him today. We've seen that taken away bit by bit, and little does Christian realize it, that their religious freedom and liberties are being taken away from them, bit by bit. And one day we're going to wake up and it's all going to be gone, just like the prayer taken out of school. We woke up one morning and it was gone because one lady stood up and the Christians stood down. So we better wake up. This thing is real. And it's about to get into the battle. It's about to get into the battle. So are you prepared? And to maybe to face the enemies, you got to be prepared. You got to have that spiritual food. Amen. And you got to be nourished. And you got to have the strength. You got to have the willingness. And you got to be ready. You got to be ready to move at any given moment and every given notice. Joshua challenged the people as a whole, and then he went and talked to a specific group here. Listen to what he says. In verse 12, and to the Reubenites, and to the Gadites, and to the half the tribe of Manasseh, speak, Joshua, saying, remember the word which Moses, the servant of the Lord, commanded you, saying, the Lord your God had given you the rest and have given you this land. Your wives, your little ones, your children, basically, your cattle shall remain in the land which Moses gave you on this side of Jordan. But he shall pass before your brothers, armed, all the mighty men of valor, and help them. Until the Lord has given you, brethren, rest, as he hath given you, they have also possessed the land which the Lord your God giveth them. Then he shall return unto the land of your possession and enjoy it, which Moses the Lord's servant gave you on this side of Jordan toward the sunrise. And they answered Joshua, saying, all that they commanded us we will do. Whithersoever they sendest us, we will go. When Joshua spoke to this tribe, it's the two and a half tribes of the tribe that was wanted to stay on the other side of this Jordan. Why? Because they were cattlemen, and the land was better for the cattle. But Joshua said, you just can't sit back and let your brothers go and fight to conquer their land. Even though you've been promised this land, you got to help your brother until they occupy the land God has promised them. So let me tell you this, folks. What is he saying to us? We got to join together if we're going to defeat the enemy. We got to join together. And if soon the churches learns this, amen, and learn what the Word of God teaches, that all born-again children of God, who is under the obedience of the Holy Spirit of God, and all the leaders will stand together, it's only then we will defeat the enemy. And Joshua is saying this to the, he says to these 2.5 tribes, you can't set out of the picture, you got to be involved. And you got to help your brother along the way. You got to help your brother conquer the land that God has promised them. Then you can go back to your land, and then you can have peace and prosperity. But until then, you got to fight the battle with them. The problem is our churches are so divided. They don't even stand on the absolute truth of God's word any longer. Why? They caved into the enemy. And friend, when you cave into the enemy and you don't stand on the absolute truth of God's word, then you're God's enemy. You're not a church. You're not a church. And I know this is going out on the airways, amen? So they need to hear it. When you go the ways of the world instead of the ways of what God has written, then you're not a church any longer. You're not a church any longer. You're a puppet for Satan and his dirty deeds. I'd rather stand on the truth of God's word and only have one listen to it than a thousands to listen to it and not heed it. You can fool me, you can fool others, but you'll never fool God. And God called us as ministers, as pastors of churches, to lead the people in His way, not our way. We're not here to gain, amen, wealth for ourselves. We're here, amen, to gain spiritual wealth for the people as a whole, for the glory of God. The problem is, too many preachers in the pulpit are there for the money. They're not there for the soul. God help us. And there's too many people sitting on a church pew, amen, want a form of godliness but deny the power thereof. They just want enough of God to get by so others will say they are godly people when their hearts are far from God. You know how you can tell the hearts for God is when they'll do anything God wants them to do. They'll be there for His commandments. Listen to what the people said. We'll do whatever You commanded us to do. We'll be there. We'll be there. We'll be there. They knew the importance of it. And we got to realize the importance of our duty today. Our duty and our call to action. We got to realize, amen, our church is at stake. Our family is at stake. Our nation is at stake. And we got to make a difference. We got to make a difference. Thank God for some of you who are stepping up. I mean, you're getting involved, and you're not only involved inside of these four walls, but you're involved outside of these four walls. And you're making a difference, whether it be politically or in our church setting and in religion. But you're making a difference because you're letting God use you. You're letting God use you. Thank God for you. Boy, it does my heart good when I see folks step up. Step up and do something instead of doing nothing. You know, you can talk about how bad things are, but that ain't going to solve how bad things are until you get involved. And you make a difference. Why complain about it if you're not willing to be a part of the solution? I said, why complain about it if you're not part of the solution? That's why the children of Israel wandered 40 years in the wilderness, because they was complainers and no doers. God let them wander around in a circle. If you quit running around in a circle, maybe God can use you to do something. You complain about this, you complain about that. Thank God, amen, for everything, you know. It might not be the best. If you give it your best shot, amen, it's the best in God's sight. But praise God, you can't give it your best if you're complaining, though. I don't know how I got here, but anyhow, listen. Yeah? Well, the church don't have this, and the church don't have that. What are you doing about it? Hello? What are you doing about it? I can only do so much, but what are you doing about it? If your church don't grow, it's your fault. Hello? You're the part of the church. You're the part. It's not just hinges on the preacher. It hinges on you. If you're not involved, then let me tell you then, folks, the other's not going to be involved. That your neighbor's not going to be involved because you're not involved. If you want your church to thrive and you want your church to be a vibrant part of your neighborhood, then it's up to you. It's up to you. If you get thrilled about the church, then the people next door to you will get thrilled about the church. But if you're going to gripe and complain about the church, they don't want to go there. They get enough of that from any other sources out there, amen? So they're not going to get there. Just, preacher, this ain't too good of a message for me. It's needful. If you just heed it, amen? And quit thinking so much about yourself and think about others. And get involved. These 2.5 tribes had to get involved. Joshua said, you're not going to sit back and let your brother struggle trying to occupy the land. You're going to help them. You're going to help them defeat the enemy. And then after they have conquered the enemy, then you can go enjoy your land as they enjoy theirs. So you in this thing together. We in this thing together. Look to your neighbor and say, we're in this thing together. We're in it together. And God is going to lead us, amen, and guide us if we just open our hearts to Him and be obedient to His Word. They had a challenge to take up their responsibility and fulfill that responsibility to help their neighbor, to achieve that which God has given them. And let me tell you something, folks. Now, when they got together, things began to happen. When they started heeding what God had commanded them to do, things started to happen. They went up to Jericho. And a couple of chapters over, further, think around chapter 6, they go up to Jericho. And the Jericho had shut the walls of the city up. Why? Because they heard about God's people that's coming their way. They heard about the God, amen, these people served. He was a mighty God. He was a mighty God. And they could not, amen, comprehend how mighty He was. So they shut up the city in hope and they could defeat this God. But God has never been defeated. And if God's people will take a stand, amen, they will never be defeated. If they'll take a stand for Him, lean on Him, and depend upon Him, they'll never be defeated. The enemy may shut up the walls of the city and say that you can't get in. You ain't not going to get in. But, amen, God has a way of bringing down walls. He has a way of moving obstacles out of the way. And all we got to do is listen to His voice, and He will give us the instruction of how to do so. As they made their way to the city, amen, they found an angel of the Lord, Joshua did, in the way. He said, are you our foe? Are you for us? Are you against us? And he says, look, hey, put up your sword. Boy, I've already been up there. This was the Lord Almighty Himself. He's already scouted out of the place. Amen. He says, you just march around the city 7 times. And he says, I'm going to give you instructions how to do that. 1 time a day. Then on the 7th day, I want you to march around 7 times around those walls of the Jericho city. He said, those walls will come down. He said, on the 7th day, on the 7th march, he said, then the people will be able to say something. They will shout, amen. They will blow the trumpets, and the walls will come down. Now, I want you to picture this, amen. When the enemy, amen, don't know what you're doing, that plays a lot of psychological part on his heart, amen. His mind is wondering, what are the crazy nuts doing now? Here they come, the whole caravan, amen, of children of Israel. Amen. And they didn't, amen, pick up a sword or anything. They just march around the wall silently. And you're talking about multitudes of people. But like this, Joshua must have just been preaching to them. They must have got home. Huh? No, I'm just kidding. Amen. Listen, amen, they went away on the while they was obedient to what the Word of God said. Joshua, this is how we're going to defeat the enemy because the Lord said that. You be quiet. The problem is sometimes we talk too much. Right? When God tells us to do something, we analyze it. We talk it out. Well, I don't know if I can do that. And we hash it back and forth, and just instead of just doing, just be quiet and do. They had to just be quiet and do it. They made a journey the first day, second day, third day. And I'm sure the enemy on the other side, what are they up to now? This is kind of strange. This is kind of odd. I have never seen anybody approach their enemy like this. We're ready for battle. We're ready to take them on. But here they are. They're marching around the walls outside the city, not doing a thing, but just marching in complete silence. Wouldn't it be wonderful if we showed up at every board of supervisors meeting and just sat in the seat silently? I'm just saying, hello? A multitude of Christian folks just gather in the halls of Congress silently. Maybe even march around the Capitol Hill. I bet you every Secret Service and every Capitol Police will be out there. What in the world are they doing? Hello? What in the world? What if God could do something that great? What if God people would just, amen, just to be obedient to Him and do what He's telling them to do? We'd make the enemy, amen, take a notice. Take notice how great our God is. He said, march around it seven times on the seventh day. And on the last time, you give it a shout. Seventh day, we're going to see something happen today. You know, I believe they were smiling on that day. Yeah. Because what is the battles is going to be won this day. The enemy thought they were secured. They thought they had everything sewed up. But on the seventh day, God showed them, as the children of Israel were obedient to His command, the seventh trip, the trumpet horn sounded, and the shout of the people, and the walls came tumbling down, exposing the enemy to the hands of the children of Israel. God took down the wall. We're going to allow God to take down the wall today that Satan has put up in our lives. Satan has put up some walls in our lives, those who are sitting here this morning, whether you want to acknowledge that or not. You know, you hadn't been victorious because you hadn't been obedient. You hadn't took up the challenge. You heard the call to duty, but you took no action. He's saying, let's take some action. You're going to have an opportunity this week to take some action. You're going to have an opportunity in the future to take some action. What are you going to do? You going to make a difference, or are you going to gripe and complain?